we create our basic core structure and what changes you have to do if you change some field. And then about our cron job, how we run our cron job, some basic stuff only. And after that, then if you guys are free, we can actually do a local setup. Can we point to Playground environment by using Odd Token Omkar just for a couple of hours?
So I think Elzan can advise there, because anyways this Playground environment
But yesterday they switched the Playground from AWS to Azure. I don't know the stability of that.
No, I checked, it's working.
Then you may go ahead.
So I will just share that Odd Token. It will be anyway expiring 2-3 hours, because I can log out and expire.
Everybody has joined the session, only like 5 people from DLT. Not even 5. 1, 2, 3.
Actually, we 4
people
are
only. 4, 5. That's all, huh?
No, no, no. Actually, me, Ragni, Rajni, Minju, and Vidya are joining through one system only, means SHO.
Okay. Thanks.
So they're joined together, it seems. So,
right.
Vipin, everyone is there, right? No, no one is missing from here.
No,
okay. So I'll start. Whenever we develop a new microservice, first what we do is create one Swagger contract. So if you see here, we just define the APIs whichever we want to create, and the POJOs, like whatever fields are required in each model. So you must be familiar with Swagger contracts, right?
Right.
Yeah. So after creating this Swagger contract, we have one library called CodeGen. So basically, we have modified the Swagger code generator to our customization and converted it into a library. So we use this library to generate the skeleton of our code so that we can directly get started without manually creating those POJOs. So I'll just show you how it works. So this is the target folder. So in this output, based on our Swagger contract, all the POJOs and controllers will be generated, and some basic the basic libraries will be imported, like Tracer, Lombok, whichever we use. So this So if you just enter here, you can see all the options you have to create the project. So I will just use this one. So if you see here, this is the URL from where I will fetch the Swagger contract. -l stands for if you want to import Lombok, -t if you want to import Tracer configuration. And -a, it specifies basically the artifact ID or the service name, you can say the context path which you will be using. So more of a service name. And -b is just the base package name which will be shown in your code structure, like what will be the top level file name in your code. So if I click enter, it will now create all these POJOs and the basic structure like controllers and all those in the output folder. If you see in this output folder, these three files are these three things are created. I'll just import this project. So you can see like this we have imported this auto-generated project. So already it has most of the dependency which we require, and all these POJOs will be automatically created according to your contract. So if you see this build, so this everything is auto-created. How we handle our list and everything will be automatically generated here. Also, there will be controllers will be generated. Controllers part is not that clean. You will have to make some changes here, but still, like overall structure will be defined here. Apart from that, some basic configuration like our Jackson beans and object mappers also will be created here. So that's the basic stuff like how we get started. So once we get this models and controllers, then according to your business logic, we will add two more classes. One is service, which will have the business logic. Like I will just compare the structure. So after that, you will just have to add this service. This service folder will contain all the business logic, whatever enrichment or whatever you have to do will be here. And after that, there will be one repo folder. It will contain a query builder. So depending on your parameters, you dynamically will create the queries, and one row mapper. So once you get your data from DB, you will have to convert into the POJO. Apart from repository and service, you will also have one validation folder, which will contain the validator classes. So it will run before in every create and update to validate if the request is correct or not. So that's the basic repo structure that we follow. Apart from that, many services will have a consumer folder. So this consumer folder will contain this Kafka consumers, which we use to perform operations in a synchronous fashion. So it's basically very straightforward. You just have to put the @ Kafka listener annotation from Spring and mention the topic names on whatever topics you want to listen. So your data will be, whenever a message is pushed on this topic, it will be consumed here. And this function will execute whatever functions you define instead of it on the message you receive from this topic. So if you see here, it's hash map string object recommends type is of hash map. This depends on the deserializer what you define in your properties. So here, if you see, we have defined the Kafka deserializer as hash map. So it depends on you, however you're comfortable, whether through string or hash map or JSON, you can define deserializer accordingly. And whatever deserializer you define, that type you have to define here. Means your record will be deserialized in that format. So once that is done, then normal processing, whatever process you want to do, either you can do it directly keeping it as a hash map, and then you will be knowing the keys, so you can operate like that, or if you want, you can even convert it to whatever required POJO is there. So one important thing while setting up your Kafka consumer is you should be always careful about the group IDs. So like if you see the receipt topic, so for this service, the group ID is ego-t-services. So if you look at this receipt consumer here, so this topic is basically listened by almost 8 to 10 services. So if any two services have the same group ID, that record will be consumed by only one service and other will skip it. So make sure that the group IDs are different if you are listening on the same topic. So that is basically the Kafka consumers. Then we also have a producer. So producer is nothing, this custom Kafka template we have. So naturally Spring provides one Kafka template. So if you just do Kafka template dot send, it will send this value, which is of type object on this topic. So custom Kafka template we have so that we can receive an acknowledgement. We'll wait for acknowledgement from the consumer that it's consumed. Before we used to use Kafka template, but there were some problems because of it. Therefore, we shifted to this custom Kafka template. Any questions on this? Okay. So suppose for customization, if you ever want to add any new field in your POJO, so one easy way we provide is in every top level objects, we have this additional detail field, which is a JSON node. So you can directly just put a key value pair and it will get persisted and will be returned in your search result if you don't want to do any processing at all on these fields. But if you are required to add a field where a lot of processing is involved in it, you can just add it in the POJO. So once you add it in Pojo, you will have to make changes at three places. One is in the persister YAML. So here, suppose in trade unit, suppose you add a new field call, suppose XYZ or something like that. You will just have to add that path here. And here also, whatever. So this order and this order has to be maintained. So it's at second place. So just one question. So that's the query change. And another thing you will have to do is add the entry in the row mapper. In row mapper, wherever you are creating the unit object, here you just have to add dot whatever XYZ. If you add it in Pojo, it will be shown here because of this getter and setter. Just add it here also. And after that, you will have to add it in the DB migration script. So we use Flyway to manage our migration script. So this is anyway. So if you want to modify any table or add any columns, you will always have to create a new file at the end of this. Because if you just change any existing file, the Flyway migration will fail and the pod will crash. So make sure, like, if you deploy a service once, then after that you will always have to create a new migration file, a new Flyway file to make any changes in it. Otherwise, the pod will crash. So that's the basic how to add a field or remove a field. So after that, then we have Zool. So this is one Zool filter. So suppose you have some requirement where incoming request you have to modify a bit, like you have to add some constant field or run some validation, some pre-processing or post-processing. So that you can do through Zool. So basically, if you see at the Zool structure, there is this post folder and a pre folder inside of filters. So these are basically just the post hooks and the pre hooks. So you just have to extend this Zool filter and override these four methods. Filter type, filter order, should filter, and run. So filter type is basically whether it's a pre, post, error, or route, whatever type of filter it is. So basically, just a pre and post error also here. So whatever type it is, you just return that type. Filter order is like in what order, means if there are n filters, at what number your filter should be executed. So you should be careful with this because sometimes you might want to do it before authorization is done or after authorization is done. So this field is important, like at what time you execute the filter. And after this, there is should filter method. So here it's returning true every time. That means you want to execute this filter on every request. But if you have a specific condition, like suppose you want for a particular URL only to execute this filter, you can write that condition here. So if request.get URL equal to something, then only return true. So whatever is your trigger should be mentioned here. And run is basically the logic. So whatever logic you want to execute on your body will go in this run method. So this is how you can define the pre and post hooks in Zool. So apart from that, then we have cron jobs. So suppose you have some processes which has to be run daily or monthly, quarterly or yearly at some specific period. So all we need is like the endpoint which you want to hit on at specific time. So if you look here, we have a MDMS config where you just define the your API specification, like what it's a post call, whatever URL it has, payload, and the content type. So this cron job will pick up these APIs, and depending on like this job name is daily, so the cron job name daily will pick up this API. This all are daily. So whatever job name you define here, that cron job will pick up this API and hit it. You can deactivate it using this active flag also required.
So what time it runs? Where do we define?
So actually, we have this kube config. So in this scheduler, you have to define the time. Generally, we have daily and monthly cron jobs running. So if there is a specific need for quarterly or yearly, you just have to change the scheduler and start a new cron job. So it's just a two-step process. You have to just create.
So all daily tasks will run at the same time? Huh?
Yeah, at the same time, at midnight. So if some specific cron job is required, you just change the scheduler time and create a new scheduler. You'll have to change the name also, and then mention whatever name is there in this file as a job name. So this is the API cron job we have. So any questions on this thing?
Ankit, suppose I want to have one Zoom filter. I mean, I want to, normally we will have our service and we will be hitting the DB as a normal flow. Suppose I want to have a pre-filter that I want to do my particular operation. After that, I need to go for the normal flow. So where I will be telling that I need to go to this Zoom filter first, we have to tell, right?
So you can just define one pre-filter here. So in this filters, there is this pre-filter. So just create one new class here.
Yes.
Suppose XYZ it is called, which implements this Zul filter.
And
this should trigger a should filter method is there. Here you have to write exact condition, like if you just want it to be intercepted only for a specific URL, then
that
will come here. Like this is, you have this request context. If you see here, this is get URI method is there. So you can just get the URI from the request context and match it against a constant value, whichever like. Either you can maintain a list also, like for this list of URLs, you execute this filter.
Okay.
That will go into your application.properties, that list. I mean, it's some constant value, right?
Okay.
And you can just check if that URL is in that given list, return true. So that particular filter will be executed.
Okay. So I have to check with the corresponding URL. If any of this is present, then I have to go to
Yeah, you can define however you want this method. So yours might be URL based or some other thing. Like depends on you how you want to execute.
Okay.
So this is. So just let me quickly add Gopesh. He is going to explain the indexer config.
Aniket, I'm.
Okay, you are adding. Okay, Gopesh is there. Gopesh. Can you give a quick overview of how do we define the indexer config?
Yeah. Okay.
So Elzan, do I need to cover anything in customization or anything?
Just a second. Let me see that list of. Things.
So already in last video I mentioned how to make changes in calculator.
Okay. Writing a new service and deploying new service, those things.
So writing a new service, I have shown like how from Swagger editor we create the basic skeleton, and from there then we start coding on that project.
Okay. So but we have to add it in the Helm and all that.
That's a part of DevOps. I guess Pradeep might be already knowing it.
Pradeep, you are aware of that? After we add a new service, what more to do?
No.
That is one thing. Persister, indexer, and on the consumer?
Consumer, I told already.
Already covered. Yeah. Then troubleshooting, I guess they're already aware of. From the network tab, right now we were showing, right? So maybe we can elaborate that. Yeah, that is it.
Okay, well, Gopi, should continue with indexer. Then I will just tell how to set up a new service, how to add configuration for new service.
Indexer, persister, both.
Okay.
Yeah. Just sharing.
Yeah, I'm facing some issues with persister also.
Yeah, we'll see. Once this is done, we can have a call and figure out all those issues.
Okay.
So is my screen visible? Hello?
Anik? Yeah.
So basically for adding any new index in on Elasticsearch, we have to just add a index configuration to indexer service. So in the indexer service, there are mainly two kind of indexes which we define in this configuration. This is a normal index, and the other is legacy index. So legacy index is used to index record from DB. So indexer will be calling some microservice like property. It depends on which record you want to index. So indexer will call these services and get the data, and then it will index that data. And the other one is this index. So it will be used to index live records, like some properties modified, it is updated or something. So all these, whenever properties modified, updated, the data goes to some Kafka topic, and from that Kafka topic, indexer will pick the record. So in the index configuration, we define all the Kafka topics from where we want to pick the records. And for on after reading a record from one Kafka topic, we can put it to more than one index. So for each of these Kafka topic, we define index mapping. So we can have more than one index mapping for one Kafka topic. Okay. So in later we define the name of the index here, and the type will be general for all of new for indexes, and for the ID. As an ID, we will be using some fields, you know, from the record which we have got on from this topic. So these fields should be unique, like the combination of these fields should be unique only. So that so Elasticsearch will pick the will put the record using this key. So if the there is one already record there which have the same key, then that record will get replaced by the Elasticsearch. And then we have this own path. So this path is just the path of the data that we want to index. So the indexer will use this path on the whichever data he got from on this Kafka topic, and then we'll apply these mappings to read records from we'll read fields from that record, and we'll generate a new structure of the data. So this we have defined here in custom mapping. And there is this timestamp field. So for every record on Elasticsearch, we have to define a field like that field would be used to get the tell the time when this record was indexed. So this is for here in this index mapping field, we have defined the overall structure of the record which would be indexed on the Elasticsearch. And now here we are providing the mappings. So these normal mappings will work. This will just read the fields from the record which we got on Kafka topic, and will fill this template. Just reading from that thing and filling in this template. It will follow this for all the fields. And then there is external URI mapping and MDMS mapping. So suppose we want to call get some data from external service. So using that, we can fill the same template with data from some other service. So here we will define the path of that service and query params. So we can use like some variables which we can use some fields which we got in our record from this Kafka topic. So suppose tenant ID and locality code, whatever was there in our property object. Using those fields, we will make a call to external service. And here we have defined the API request body or token. So after that, we will write this same mapping here also, like input JSON path, output JSON path. So now this input JSON path would be applied on the data what we got from that external service. Here we were applying this on Kafka record topic, but here it would be applied on whatever we got from the external service. And the output JSON path for all would be same for the same path for this template would be used. So like data word we have defined here somewhere. And there is this MDMS mapping. So this MDMS mapping is also for external call only, but there are some special case for MDMS service, like this MDMS service supports filter also. So JSON filters also. So that for that we have defined this as a special case. And then this input and output is same as used in these sections. So this is about the index. So this is a live index, like whenever any property is modified or something happens, so the service concerned services will put their record on topics and indexer will read from that. So like here we are reading in case of save property. So we have mapping for update property also, if the record is updated, and here cancel also. So on all of these actions, the record would be updated. So here one thing to notice that on cancel property, we are not creating any new record or index. We are updating the old record only. So here we are using the same ID used in save topic. So first time when the property is created, it would come on save property index, and with this combination, with actual values read from that record, property and tenant ID, the record would be pushed on the Elasticsearch. And when update comes, the property ID, since these two fields are constant only, so when update comes, the same, since we are using the same key, so this record would get updated, whichever we had pushed during this save property registry. same record would be updated in case of update or cancellation or etc. So if we want any new record on update or cancel, we can use some other combination of ID which is unique for every update or cancellation, etc. So this is about live index, and other is legacy index. like I said, legacy index is used for indexing old data. So first one was for live indexing, like some property modify or something. We are directly reading from Kafka topics. Now here the records are in DB, and those are not on Kafka topic. So we need to get them and push them to this some Kafka topic. So here we have defined the Kafka topic where we want indexer to push the records, and when this record is pushed on that Kafka index, then the process would be same as here as the last index. So one thing is that the map, this mapping portion and all would be same as earlier, and these ID, JSON path, these all are same. Only thing is this we have added this field as bulk here. So because we are getting property arrays instead of just one property. So note this JSON path $.properties.star we have used here, and earlier we were just directly using $.property. So there in the record there was only one property, so we were using this path. Now there are multiple properties, so we are using this star operator. So now the indexer will get array of properties. Now we need, using this field, we will tell indexer that this is a bulk thing. This the whatever path you have, data you have filtered is a array. So you need to handle them separately. So here we have defined this, and is bulk equal to true. So for this legacy index, we need to hit indexer service. For example, here. So here I am calling this index legacy index using this REST. Here this the topic is there, the same topic I will be using, registry or application. There are two kind of legacy index I have defined, so that I am using. So for the restarting the reindexing job, we need to hit this indexer manually with this request body. So here we have defined the service from where we will getting the data. So here in case, here I am getting from property service. You might be according to your requirement, you may need to fetch it from TL, trade license, PGR, etc. So and this endpoint supports limit and must. These endpoints must support this limit and offset field. So like indexer will be picking, calling this service and getting the data in chunks of 50 records using this offset field. It will keep on increasing this field and will get all the data. And here we have defined legacy index topic that should match with the legacy index topic that we have defined here. And we need to hit this endpoint with this request body, and then the process would be same as the live index, and it will index the record. So that is all about this index config.
So basically, this index config helps us to easily transform the JSON to the given format, that whatever is written there in index mapping. But if we have some complicated transformation to do, which cannot be done with this functionality, then we write some custom logic in our indexer service, which makes API calls, fetches data, does some transformation, and then creates a JSON. Gopesh, can you just show that part where we have this PT custom in data enrichment?
Basically, if we add a new field in PT or TL, what are the kind of changes we have to do to the existing YAML?
If you see, if we see at this structure, this basically has like top level objects like Gopesh, show that property detail and property, we index that whole property detail object, right?
Actually, in the new index, the property detail object is not there. I will show some.
Okay, just show how to add that new entry in index, new variable entry in index in the config.
So here in the index mapping, this is the template we are using. So we will add the field here, whatever new field is there. So like wherever we want to keep this, we have full control of this template. So we can have different structure than the object we are receiving from Kafka topic. So we can have structure according to our needs. So we will add the field here, somewhere here, wherever we want to add. And for that, we will write the in JSON mapping. So suppose we added the name thing. So we will write here the path of the name field in the property object. In input from input path field, and output JSON path would be where we want to keep that name. So suppose we want to keep this inside data workflow, and parallel to this action we want to keep. So we will write the path at $.data.workflow.name. So this, so only this much we have to add for adding new field. So make sure this mapping is added in all the configurations, like this index. We are using multiple mappings for this index. So in all the indexes, we have to update.
So if we add a new field after data started indexing, we'll have to re-index all the previously indexed data.
Yeah, we will have to run this legacy index job that I explained earlier. If we change any structure of the already indexed JSON. So Aniket, yeah. So here, there was some special case for PGR and PT. So we have refined here some custom mapping. For example, for PT, we wanted to change the structure of this consumer code. Like we wanted to make the combination of two fields into one and then set the consumer code. So we have written some custom logic here. So likewise, if there is some custom code which can't be handled from some logic which can't be handled through indexer config, then we have to add some custom logic. Hello.
Yeah. So, any questions are there on indexer? Hello.
What kind of hello? Am I audible?
Yeah. Volume is actually very less.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah. Yeah. You're audible.
Do we index every kind of data that comes into the system or
no so it depends on what dashboards you are displaying. So if your dashboard needs some certain 4 or 5 fields, they want to aggregate data on or display something, so only depending on that you will index your data. And generally we avoid indexing PII data, so we remove out all the mobile number, name, such data, only like locality and then what is the collection against one locality. Such a data will index. So it
okay,
depends on your dashboard. Like whatever means whatever pie charts or graphs you want to show. So depends on that. That's how you will have to define the index structure.
Okay. The main purpose is for the dashboard to be displayed, right? Only
yeah,
for
yeah.
that purpose we are storing it in the indexer.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
So what indexer service does basically is it just consumes from Kafka, does some data transformation so that we can create indexes which can be easily used by our Kibana dashboard or DSS service.
Okay.
We just put it on the indexer using API. Sorry.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Hello. So there is one more functionality in indexer, like sometimes we want to mask some field like user PIIs or something. So for that, those we have this field to be masked, and we can provide the path of those variables. So in that indexer, those field would become as masked fields.
Masked in the sense, will it be
like
set to
XXX something like cross.
Okay.
Yeah.
So okay, Gopesh, I will present. So in my last session, I actually explained how the persister config works. So do you guys have any question on this, or should I move ahead from? Hello.
Actually, these Kafka topics are there. Now, how internally like it is getting created? Yesterday, whatever you told that configuration we did. After that Kafka topic got created by itself. No, where is
yeah,
it?
Yeah. So whenever you start Spring service, right? It will automatically create the Kafka topics.
Okay.
Whatever
the name configuration and all, where you have written, like for like once we start, these topic names only should get created.
So whatever are there in your consumers will get created automatically.
Okay. Fine. Okay.
Even like if you have something in your producer.push method, then it will create it if it's not available.
Okay, depending on that name, topic name only, it is getting created.
Yeah. So if you're trying to push, it will always push on topic. It won't wait whether it exists or not. It will create and then it will push.
Okay.
So again, I will just give a quick overview of what our persister config does basically. So it will listen on a particular topic. And then once it gets any message from this topic, it will this query maps we define. So it will just run all the queries which are defined in this query maps. So what this query does exactly is it will just fetch the data using JSON parse from the incoming object, and it will just fill it here and get executed. So that's basically it. So even if you have like a list of arrays, so from our base path we can extract them as a list. Means the purpose of using base path is because if you have a list of accessories inside a trade license object, then it will extract using base path the whole list, and then one by one it will insert it. It will execute this JSON parts on each object and it will insert it. Apart from that, one more thing we have is this curly braces. So it's our customization. So if you put a curly brace around some field, so what it will do is it will fetch this ID field from this base path and replace it in it here before executing the JSON path. So we use it to refer to a parent foreign key. So if you look at, let's take an example of some other. So if you look here, this is a trade unit. I will just show you the JSON object. So inside of trade license detail, we have a trade units object, means it's an array. So if you look here, trade license detail ID is its foreign key, so it's linked with this table, trade license detail table. So to link it with that table, we need to extract the trade license detail ID first using JSON path. So what this statement actually does is it says like, give me the trade license detail which has this particular ID in trade license, in trade units ID. Means when we put curly braces here, it will just replace that ID field inside with ID field in this path. So whatever trade unit will have, so this is the trade unit we'll have. So it will just put this value here. So then it will search for that ID. So whichever license has this UUID, that license, trade license detail it will fetch, and that trade license detail ID it will fetch for using this path. So once you like run it locally, you will able to see like how it actually works. So it's basically used for referencing the parent level foreign key. So any questions on this persister config? Hello.
Ankit?
Yeah.
Ankit, one more thing. In that persister, once there was two things, like one, we can add this additional details that you told, if we are not doing any operation with that particular field.
Yeah.
Does that means like we just need to display anything, or like I am not doing any business operation with that? Just for the display purpose, if I want to add any extra column or any extra data, that I can directly add into this additional details.
Yeah, yeah. So suppose if we have here additional. So in your UI, will just send a key value pair here like this. So this will be the key, this will be value. So it will be persisted in your DB also, and it will be written in your search response also.
Okay. I mean, it is just for the display for the purpose. If I want to display any additional data other than whatever it is available in our DB, that's it.
Yeah. So if tomorrow some requirement comes and they are asking to capture some new field, then you can just put it directly here without changing any code.
Okay.
So,
Aniket, one thing was that in that persister, right, you seem to be referring to this chatbot.yaml. Any specific functionality here?
Chatbot.yaml?
Yeah, that is what I've been getting error on, because that is not found in the repo.
So actually, every service has its own YAML. So like this is tradelicense.yaml, which has the queries for trade license. So that must be chatbot's YAML, chatbot service YAML. So if you're getting error,
because of that.
Okay, just remove it. Anyway, not required.
Where do I remove it from? I can't be doing it. It is within the Docker image. I need to get a new image then.
Just remove it from the path. So if you go into InfraOps.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, InfraOps, there is that variable which is list. So you, if
So basically, the way I understand, only the YAMLs which are required for the service need to be in that list.
Yeah, correct. So yeah. Whatever services you have running and are using persister, only those YAMLs should be there in that path.
But they have just, for sake of, I think, easier access, everything is put.
Yeah, I guess they must have just copied everything from there.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay. So apart from that, if you have a new service, so suppose I created one new service called a portion service. So to deploy it, basically, as Nitin already mentioned in his DevOps session, you will have to add its entry into this build config here.
This point, I think he has explained, right? Yeah.
It's explained, right, already?
Yeah, I got it.
So nothing much, like you
but
just...
go on once more, because at least from your perspective, I'll have a...
Okay, fine. Just give me one second. So, this is the basic, very basic service, a portion service. So it doesn't use any endpoints, nothing. So you, if you see here, we have just defined one init container. Means this is like standard code. You can just reuse this part. How to set up an init container label. So here you have to name your service. Then these are the container configs, like how much memory you have to give. So whenever you create a new service, you will have to create this values.yaml file, and this will be the environment variables. So apart from that, you just need, it's not required also, but if any service is pointing to it internally, then you will just have to mention
that's it.
And then after that, if you just add that entry in this build.config,
yeah,
anyway, get picked by the build job.
Yeah.
So that's only like very only two-step procedure. Just create this values.yaml, and it will then, after that, just add in this build config, and it will be picked up by the builder. Then you can deploy it. So I guess that's it from my side. If you guys have any questions.
And regarding these hooks for the implementing the services, is there any kind of hooks and all? Because some days back, somebody told that you will be providing some hooks for implementing the services, like overriding any service like that.
So basically, we have those Zool hooks for now, which I showed, this pre-filter and post-filter. Apart from that, functional level hooks, actually, we do have, but we are not sure about it. So I will have to like come back on that one. Whether they should be used or you should branch out and create another custom service.
Okay.
Aniket, I can see a number of YAMLs being referenced within this persister, like this fire and OC.
Yeah, we can remove all those. Only whatever pods you have running, right? Only those we can.
Okay. So that is how it is. Okay, every pod which requires a persistent service requires to present a YAML in this.
Correct. So another one thing is like if you mention some topic like from topic in persister, this. So just make sure that all queries are in the same query map. Otherwise, if you just put from topic at two places, then again that.
One place it will get consumed.
Yeah, that consumer won't work as we expected. That message will get consumed and only half query will be.
So the configuration is like the entire your persister is one, belongs to one group.
Yeah, persister has its own group.
Yep, entire persister service is belongs to one group and.
So generally what we follow is we just create separate groups for each services. We don't there is no requirement as such as of now to have two services belonging to same group.
Okay.
But by generally by mistake, sometimes people just copy the application properties and they leave it there.
Yeah, then only one service will be getting randomly some.
And it's very difficult to debug also. You won't notice it. Yeah. So we can try that local setup with playground or token if you guys have a system ready from engineering team.
That auth token, how to get it?
I will send you in chat. Okay. So can you guys just start the Kafka server and just start the IDE?
Okay.
Aniket, meanwhile, can you tell me that this YAML, what did this specific YAMLs contain? This has that been explained or something?
Which YAMLs?
Whichever we are configuring into the service, like this fire service and this, that, and all the pods that are running have a YAML to be configured with persister, right? So in that we specify something.
You are talking about every service that uses persister as a YAML specific.
Yeah. What do we
say? This file only, which I showed.
Okay.
So we just specify the queries that has to be executed on the top.
Okay, got it.
This is from. So this one.
You have picked up just trade lines license now, but it will be having many things.
Yeah. So, Pradeep, can you see if I am there on that Slack channel? I'm not able to find you actually on Slack.
Yeah, actually, you are in that group, Slack, na?
Yeah. I tried ping him, but it was different.
I'll ping you. I think you're not there.
Which channel is this, Pradeep?
This OMCB Bell, mod OMCB Bell. Nikesh and Manju have been added.
Mod OMCB Bell, okay. Yeah, I can see.
Yeah, I guess he was direct pinging me, so that also is not happening because he is not visible to me in any channel, I guess.
I'll just come back into it.
I think we have covered most of the topics except the configuration stuff related to new services.
I think he just mentioned that by configuration, you mean that adding that values.file and adding to the build config, right? Or something else.
Right.
Yeah. That I think, yeah.
Okay. He went. Because I'm just thinking from the angle, like, kind of work you'll be doing is maximum adding some new consumers or maybe one or two new services or adding some extra fields in the existing services.
Yeah.
So that way, what are the changes that has to be done, both in indexer, persister? Mostly it will be add-ons, new services adding also for TL, MCS may not be required unless some pre-hooks are posted.
Yeah.
Aniket, you're going to present something?
No, Elzam, we just need to set up the local for engineering team once, so that once their environment starts, they can just replace the link and get started.
Okay. Meanwhile, any questions are there? Please go ahead. We are actually covering the entire digit. Next is only DSS and the mobile app thing pending. So any doubts, please ask.
Hello.
Hello.
Can you tell me one use case where post hook is applicable? When do we write post hook?
So one case was in Punjab, I guess, for Jalandhar, for specific tenant, they have some use case where for a year, I guess 13, 14, they wanted to set the interest to zero. So what we did was we intercepted the call after calculator, this demand call, and just set the value to zero.
That is a pre-hook, right? You intercept the call and...
Post. Okay. After demand is generated, right?
Okay.
That time we did it. Means suppose you want some calculation to complete, and after just you want to modify one thing. So if I would have modified the interest amount beforehand only, the calculator would have again override it and then stored, right? So in that case, we just put a post hook where it let the calculator calculate the whole amount and then change the amount to zero.
Okay. But any changes to the DB it is required?
No. You might have to do a API call inside of it. So suppose your calculator have already persisted the demand, right? Then once you intercept the callback from the calculator, you will have to update the demand. So it depends exactly how you are using the filter.
Okay, means is it possible in all the cases that we address the issue just by writing pre-hook or post-hook, or we may have to change make changes in the DB as well in some situations where it is just not possible to.
Yeah, you might have, because if before your post hook intercepts, if before that only it's getting persisted in DB, then you will have to make a call from your hook to override the changes in DB. That is possible.
Okay. Now my question is, can all the situations be handled just by writing pre-hook and post-hook, or any changes in the DB is also required?
It's inside the code you are saying.
Changes in the DB.
Sorry, I didn't understand. Changes in DB, which you are saying like, can you just explain?
See, in the current product, you have given some configurations and some predefined this thing is there.
Yeah.
Accordingly, some set of codes are running. If we want to make any changes, will pre-hook, writing pre-hook and post-hook will always help, or any further modifications is?
Pre-hook and post-hook will always, you will be always able to achieve whatever you want. But the thing is, like, sometimes, the amount of code that will go in your pre-hook or post-hook will be so big that you will rather write custom logic inside the code. It means you can check out the branch and create another branch. So it depends. Yeah. So if there is a minor change, then the hooks are useful. But if like complete logic you have to rewrite in the hook, then it doesn't make sense.
Okay.
Aniket, I have sent mail
to
the team. I'll just be back in 2 minutes.
Aniket, can you send us the complete postman call only so that...
I guess Elzan shared, no?
That is related to some front-end thing. Is that related to this?
Call. I just pinged Elzan the call. Actually, I don't have your email addresses.
Okay. We'll check 1 minute.
I think, Aniket, every other file now it is failing. We go purchase a trade license. It has come to that now.
What is the error?
Yeah, failed to fetch file. Work dir configs ego persistent trade license.
Okay. So can you just go inside the pod and see?
I'll check.
It's not. I think it won't be like getting not able to read only those files from GitHub.
Yeah.
We'll have to check the repo path, I guess.
Yeah, repo path.
So the app is starting or?
Yeah, this is to me or them?
No, to engineering team. Whether that like app has started or it's.
Aniket, what are we doing right now?
So they are doing local setup actually.
Okay, then, doing screen sharing with you?
Ragini, hello.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, can you guys just share the screen? Is it possible to share the screen?
No, actually we are doing in a different system.
Okay.
We are just starting the Postgres and trying that. Just 2 minutes.
Can we stop the recording, Aniket? Because I want to use this as a...
Okay, I will just disconnect the call then.
Yeah, you can end the recording and then probably continue the call if you want.